I'm really happy to have people want to know something more about Kucha. Yeah, I'm really happy about it, that there is interest among people mostly concentrated on Eastern Buddhism. The title may be a little bit irritating, as we hear just a minute ago, but I hope I will show you what is it about. So here we are, which is quite far away in the west of China. It was always far away from sort of everywhere, actually, from central China, but also from central India or from Iran. It was sort of far away from everywhere. There is this huge desert, Taklamakan, and the Silk Road has the southern part and the northern part. And some on the middle of the northern, there is Kucha. As you see below in the lower right corner, Kucha people were redheaded or blonde. And this make them some really, that's somehow of importance of their entire culture. They spoke Indo-European languages. There's people from the Kucha area, Turfan area. Easier for them was to understand Sanskrit than Chinese. And also they were sort of fascinating with Indian culture. They kept on stories on language. We have very many bilingual manuscripts. So for them was somehow of importance, like part of their identity, to stay in connection with Indian culture. So that's why this is just this area, because already of geography, on Silk Road, Buddhism came to China, and interestingly, and also that I will show you today, that somehow quite often happens that people think this is Indian culture what we have, but anything like that exists in India. This is actually coming from Kucha only. So about Kucha people, we actually do not know much, but because we have mostly this religious places. Briefly, between 5th and 10th century. The dating is open question. I wouldn't like to talk about that. Some Chinese scholars would like to date them much earlier. We still don't know exactly, but just approximately is the approximately 500 years, second part of the first millennium. There are groups of man-made caves, which we know today by modern names, Kizilgaha, Subashi, Kumtura. The biggest of them here in the middle is Kizil. Now, it is not very interesting when we look at the caves from outside. Also in the antiquity, there were sort of verandas in front, but out of wood. But inside, the caves are really extremely interesting, especially because of narrative representations. Most of the paintings are of narrative characters. And this is also what you see here on five examples. This is the most typical cave with corridors on the back, on the rear. You can one can circumambulate the main Buddha in the niche. And as you see here, the dominating color is blue. Now, these paintings They show particular order. In these corridors at the rear, we have Parinirvana space with representations of dying Buddha. It starts with Vaishali, ends with first council after the Buddha's death. This is at the rear. We will not talk about that today. But on the walls and on the barrel walls, we have what we usually call preaching scenes or sermon scenes. They can show exactly the same narrative. What you see here is Hariti. There is a demoness and there is a boy sitting in the bowl. Everybody knows the story, so I don't have to say it. But just have a look at this representation of the side walls. There are very many different persons. While in this diamond-shaped representation of the barrel walls, and the story is really reduced to the most important representations, only demoness, Hariti, and the boy. Now, in general, we can say that Kucha art follows Indian art. They have more, and there are sometimes more than 100 narratives in one interior, so they have different representations, but in generally, you will know probably dying Buddha and Vajrapani dropping Vajra, Supadra, last convert, Mahakashyapa meeting Ajivika, or Mahakashyapa touching the feet of the Buddha. So this, and there are content of this and depiction that, is really taken from Indian tradition. However, there is something really very, very much different, and this my talk begins here. What you see here are four kings. There are four great kings, four green kings of directions. And on the enlargement above, you can see that they are shown like demons. They have teeth, they have sometimes animals, sometimes the speaky ears. They have iconography of demons. Nothing like that can be found in India. This is really completely different. And it is in the scene of Parinirvana, above the dying Buddha, but this is also on other representations. Just four kings of directions are shown like demons. But not only there, this one is, let's call him Yaksha. He's standing on the entrance to the cave, and again is depicted with this really, well, speaky ears. He's really sort of spooky. Now, again, I must say, it may appear in India in the time like 10th or 11th century, when already tantric movements is there, but nowhere like in 5th or 7th century. That's actually really not existent on the subcontinent. Even Vajrapani is also shown with blue skin, which is also danger, with third eye and with demonic teeth. Now, among preaching scenes on the walls and also in the barrel walls, we have plenty of representations like that. There is the Buddha in the middle, and we have person adoring him. In the drawing, you can see it better. There are deities. Brahma and Indra with third eye directly above the Buddha. There are some musicians, some Gandharvas, but the rest who is here, except of two monks, there are demons. Again, demons, and some of them are really very, very much scary. Now, interesting point about it is that such scenes are so popular. Only in few cases front part of the caves, this antechamber, is preserved. And where is preserved? There were scenes with demons, like large representation on the entire wall. Inside the caves, and we usually have 8 scenes on each side wall. Not everyone is preserved, but approximately 4 or 5 show again the Buddha surrounded by different demons. And there is still something much more confusing. There are demons attacking the Buddha. When you see something like that, the first thought is maybe they are just simplified representations of Maravijaya, when Mara depicted several times, or his different soldiers are shown attacking the Buddha. But this is not the case, because among these scenes with different, sometimes many armed demons attacking with stones, with spears, attacking the Buddha, in many, a really considerable number, on the side of the Buddha, a monk is represented. When we have a monk in the depiction, it is always that the sign we are after first sermon. So we can completely exclude that representations like that show Maravijaya. This is something when the Buddha already has Sangha. Now, it is not only pictures in Kucha which show that topics with demons were so popular. In no less than 28 manuscripts, the Atanatika Sutra has been preserved, which is one of the most popular manuscripts found in the on the Northern Silk Road, mostly in Kucha. This Atanatika Sutra in Sanskrit was edited and translated into German by Helmut Hoffmann. There is Pali version being Dika Nikaya 32. There is a Tibetan version and also Chinese version, this Taisho 1245. Interestingly, this Atanatika Sutra has not been incorporated into Chinese Dirga Agama or Madhyama Agama. It's just a separate text, not incorporated into, like, in Sanskrit or in Pali. Now, it was shown already like 100 years ago that this Atanatika Sutra was of huge importance in India, like in Bharat, which is the oldest what we have from Indian art at all, that second century BCE. You see this railing with a lot of representation of narrative character, but the arrows show bigger sculptures. There are yakshas and nagas depicted there. This one is the most important. It's for the first time when we have Kubera Vaishravana. His name is Yaksha Kubera in Bharat. And we have another one. His name is Virudaka Yaksha. Why it is so important? Because these two, already in second century BCE, are shown with sort of iconography. One is standing on sort of really strange being, another on the rocks and has stupa above. This is Virudaka, is on the south. South is the direction of death. So that's the stupa above is probably not by chance. And this is with Kupiro Yako and Virudako Yako, which is really order which we have in this Atanatika Sutra Chatur Maharaja means four great kings. In Chinese, I know that you are usually talking about heavenly kings, nothing like that. They are called great kings, and actually they do not belong in heaven in Indian tradition. So if you write about Indian tradition, please not about heavenly kings. This is the order what we have in Atanatika Sutra. The four great kings are coming not alone, but there are yakshas, kandarvas, kumbandas, and nagas who accompany them. Now, this so popular in Kucha Atanatika Sutra is really of importance for us here. Good to know what is it about. It takes place in Shravasti. The Buddha is visited by great king Kubera Vaishravana. He comes in the evening, accompanied by his yakshas, and he describes all these realms of different beings. He said about monks who are meditating in the wilderness that they are very often harassed by bad, wicked yakshas and by local spirits who are called here Naivasikas. Please remember this word, we'll come to this word also later. Vaishravana describes all these Pishachas, Pretas, Kataputanas, Rakshasas, all these really evil beings who can harass monks. And he offers protective spell. This is this Atanatika Sutra for the monks. Interestingly, the Buddha repeats all this talk of Vaishravana again. So at the end, this is not Vaishravana who gives this Atanatika Sutra, but this is the monks get the sutra from the Buddha directly, from the Buddha himself. Now, again, one really important text, again by German. It sometimes really makes sense to learn German to have access to such important research. Heinrich Luders, I hope you heard about him once. He had this really interesting papers. Which is on the history and geography of East Turkestan from 1922 and 1930. Luders concentrated on this in his papers on geography and on names from the vicinity of Kucha, which is of less importance for me, but in this group of texts, which he edited and translated partially into German in the papers, there are also names of different spirits, different deities, different demons. This text are actually something really very, very special. There are donation forms. Written on in Sanskrit on papers, they are really forms just to fill out to donation by, and you have to insert the name and what is donated. You have to insert how many coins or whatever that was. Just real forms to be filled out. That was written in Sanskrit. Brought to Berlin from Kucha and from Shorchuk, which is also on the northern Silk Road. Now, interesting point about it is that actually these donations goes to the monks, to the Sangha, but the merit of the donation should go to benefit the deceased person, who are sometimes really called by names, and to different spirit deities. And of course, such donation bring good fortune to the donor. Who is colder? Actually, many names we know from Atanatika Sutra already. Chatur Maharaja, Brahma, Chakra, or Indra. But there are also local names like Vyagra, the protector of the area. Several yakshas are called by name, Manipadra, Purnapadra. There are names also known from India. There are Gandharvas, guardians of the borders, guardians of monastery, Nagara Devatas, and protecting realms of the Kucha. What we are touching here is really living Buddhism. It's really something what we can say, this donation, somebody will come and feel that and say, okay, I'm giving so and so many pieces of money, or I invite the Sangha for food. So, and what I give to the Sangha, please, that this yakshas benefit from them. Now, one of these donation forms in Sanskrit, Sanskrit text terminates, and there is still additional couple of lines added in Tocharian A language. Let it be here. May the jewel of Bhikshu Sangha give this Dharma donation to the gods and to the and Naivasikas. And now we still read gods and Naivasikas who have been entrusted to guard the three jewels. So who are those Naivasika who, as a matter of fact, like in tantric Buddhism, really turned to Dharmapalas, to protectors of the Dharma? The word is actually quite difficult to understand because it has meanings which are very popular and used in different context. It simply means local or inhabitant, somebody coming from here. But there is also a specific meanings, locally dwelling spirit deities. Gregory Chopin analyzed several of texts dealing with this Naivasikas, and he could figure out that there are actually always evil beings. They are listed, for example, among all this category. I'm sorry. Categories of beings who cannot harm the Buddha or the Bodhisattva. So they belong to this, all Rakshasas and Naivasikas too. The Naivasikas really seek to harm people. They are absolutely evil beings. But what we can have heard before, that they are actually asked to protect. So we have these different spirit deities, among them Naivasika, who definitely have to be understood like somebody local. And they are originally bad and evil, but turn, probably because of the donation, to the protectors. Actually, this is what our representations are showing. We have really that, I don't want to call them Naivasikas, let's say the demons attacking the Buddha. We have demons represented in the sermon scenes around the Buddha, which so they adore the Buddha. So the meaning is the Buddha definitely has them under control. And we also have same looking beings at the door who protect the monasteries. And as we had seen in this donative forms. The doni is the sangha, but the merit that comes from the donation is to benefit the deceased and the deities. And about deceased, you will still hear more after. Now, the same word, naivasika, appears also in Atanatika Sutra, not in Pali, but in this Sanskrit. I'm sorry for a minute. I have a medicine which I have to swallow. It will work. Sorry for that. I'm somehow cannot get rid of this coughing. Now, by Helmut Hoffmann, who understands this this sutra like sort of raksha, protective literature, found out that there are these yakshas, non-humans, and local demons, which are definitely vyadas, so with negative connotation. And so we have that in this local donative forms, and we have that also in this Atanatika Sutra, one of the most popular sutras in the area. There is one really interesting book. It is not only about Indian culture. He gives also examples from Tibet and from China, and shows mechanisms by means of which the Sangha made itself relevant to the community. It shows really the beginning of how does it start when new monks came to the area, how what was interesting for the community when they come, how can they be more interested, like Brahmanika or Taoist community there. They had a lot. What was of importance? Ability not to be influenced by fear or desire. Of course, they could meditate. They had this really important ability, and they can refuse the authority of the spirits in the domain of the Sangha. Instead, they would convert the spirits into Buddha followers. The Karoli writes really in a wonderful way, the Sangha repeatedly positions itself as the buffer between the people and those capricious beings of desire and whim. I can really recommend this book. It reads like, well, you are interested to others on the next page. It's absolutely great book, Antique the Buddha, Indian Popular Religions and Formation of Buddhism. Now, Robert De Caroli goes so far that he even understands the Bodh Gaya, the place of enlightenment of the Buddha, the place of Maravijaya, as being originally the place of Brahmanika ritual for the death. We call that Shraddha. Shraddha rituals in Sanskrit. The word is known also in Tocharian. It's quite popular in Buddhism also, but originally this is Brahmanika ritual. Now, this is something what we actually cannot be sure about. What we do know is that in this historical place of Bodh Gaya, we really have a Buddhist site and also burial ground, a lot of graves, tombs, Brahmanika temples. What was earlier is actually impossible to say, but as a matter of fact, it makes sense that the Buddha chosen this place because it was of such spooky place in earlier times, just to show to the community that he is in the position to fight against them, like later the Sangha. The point is that from the earliest Indian art, earliest Buddhist art, which is this borrowed from the second century BCE, we always have representations of demons against whom the Buddha must fight. At least in art, maybe texts might be earlier, but what the art tells us from the earliest, we do have the demons. Now, there is another really famous paper by Gregory Schoppen, originally from 1996 in the Festschrift Schlingloff, later 2006, re-edited in this Buddhist Monks and Business Matters. The paper is about immigrant monks who are coming to start the Sangha on a new area, and the proto-historical death. Actually, this paper is nothing else like very sober way, sober analysis of archaeological data. How many times we have from Indian subcontinent, or from Gandhara also, that Buddhist settlements are in the next vicinity of burial grounds, of earlier cemeteries. Sometimes they are put even on the top of them. So that was really not by chance that Buddhist monks came there and found that their places to stay in their vicinity. We have that represented, of course, many times, and all texts say monasteries were, of course, outside of the city. But outside is it's not enough. Like in Pitalkora, for example, which is from the at least second century BCE, some people say even third century BCE, Mahamayuri, as a text about different yakshas in connection with different geographical area. So Pitalkora was really known like the place of yakshas. We have particular names which yakshas were staying in the area. It is fascinating place, but sort of spooky, actually. That's really not dark and wet. So yakshas were perhaps not really sitting in very comfortable area, and it starts to be a really important center for Buddhist monks. De Caroli analyzed several Vinaya rules concerning the measures to reduce the unpleasant smell. There is also really much telling narrative from by Shajyavastu Mulasarvastivada Vinaya about the monk who could not concentrate because of smell coming from the cemetery. So such texts in the Vinaya are actually really many, that the Buddha allows perfumes or flowers in for monks. So that must have been an issue for monks. So they were there, and probably that smell in the vicinity of cemeteries was not the worst. There was this presence of all these spirits which were there. The Caroli calls that the Sangha became the guardian of native death. Publicly recognized expert in dealing with both spirit deities and the death. these evil spirits had no access to the monastery, or they could come, but they had to turn to be followers of the Buddha. It's actually what we have in our paintings in Kucha. Not to forget, of course, is Ashupa Bhavana, meditation of impurity, which we have across entire Buddhist world. So that was for the monks, definitely from the very beginning, also an important factor to stay in the vicinities of the cemeteries. Now, what about Kucha? The biggest site is Kizil, with approximately 230 caves. One third of this cave was painted. Not every cave was painted. Dormitories of monks or meditating caves were not decorated. Among these caves, the most popular are these central pillar caves, what I showed you at the beginning, these blue ones. The question is, which caves are the earliest? Archaeologists know that quite exactly. There are caves decorated with the so-called first Indo-Iranian style. Giuseppe Vignato, whom maybe you know from Beijing, professor of archaeology in Beijing, calls that not first, but style A, but also he is of opinion this style was the earliest. How to recognize? Actually, it's not so difficult. The style is really different between first and second Indo-Iranian style, but style is something maybe can be different opinion, but we also have, like in the second style, there's a lot of blue, which is lapis lazuli. Lapis lazuli is coming from Afghanistan, and apparently there was only during the second Indo-Iranian style, in the sixth, probably starting like in the middle of the sixth century, and the ways to Afghanistan were already open. There is no lapis lazuli in these earlier paintings. Also, architecture of the caves is different, with this corridors for circumambulation of the main Buddha. This is typical for second Indo-Iranian style. In first Indo-Iranian style, we have square caves with dome or with one vault. Now, this earlier caves are in the middle in District 1. And archaeologists have really very good and important reason to say that this is the oldest part of Kizil. The reasons of that are very rational. This is the easiest access, this is the best water supply, this is the best place where the sun is always coming. So just to expect that was the beginning of entire area really makes a lot of sense. However, we also have several caves with first Indo-Iranian style on the periphery, really quite far away. I will show you a couple of them, 116, 118, which are quite far on the north. After that, we go to 212 on the western part, and then still 92. Let us begin with 118. This is a very famous cave, today unfortunately not existent in such state, so I'm showing you historical photographs made by French Central Asian Mission. It entire cave represents actually only one narrative. This is a narrative about King Mandatar. This is a Jataka, so Mandatar was is the Buddha in the previous birth. Strange story, because Mandatar is really very, very greedy. After he conquered entire earth, he came to Indra and got from Indra half of his throne in Trayastrinsha heaven, and then decided to be better than Indra. And in this moment, he fell down from heaven. You see that on the upper right part. He got sick and died. So greedy king, really not perfect character. It is a Jataka, so we actually don't know what happened to him in his next birth, but it's sort of karmic retribution must have come. The cave that was 118, the cave in the vicinity, 116, shows Ashoka Bhavana, meditation on the corpses, and so the monk is depicted there with really fascinating representation, and one should ask, of course, why something like that was there. I will suppose maybe there was originally really a place for to put out human corpses. Let us move again to now 212, which is on the west of Kizil, of the area. Fascinating cave, long one, with two really interesting narratives on the side walls. On the lower left, you see a picture from the exhibition. They call it actually clone, so that they are not copies, but really perfect clones of old papers, old paintings. Important to know that there are two rows of paintings. The lower one, which is partially preserved in situ, shows monks. The parts from another wall, which was taken to Berlin, gives us really a hint that again this Ashoka Bhavana could have been a subject here. The upper rows show on one side Shrona Kotikarna and on another Maitra Kanyaka. The Shrona Kotikarna, which is Divya Vadana number one, is also preserved in Tokarian manuscript. This is the story about pretas, hungry ghosts. Shrona Kotikarna goes from one group to another and has to hear about hungry ghosts who asked him for food or water. The point is, you cannot give anything to the pretas. They would turn to the most disgusting things. It's absolutely impossible to feed the pretas directly. So that was one wall with Shrona Kotikarna. This culminates on the front wall with representation of the female preta. It's exactly what the text of Shrona Kotikarna Vadana says. This is the female preta who has to cook her own body if she wants to eat anything. So this terrible fate of the pretas. On another wall, we have Maitra Kanyaka Avadana, which is Divya Avadana 38. Maitra Kanyaka committed terrible sin. He kicked his mother. After that, he's wandering through different realms, and on the end, he comes to hell, where he has to suffer terribly. There is iron will, which is cutting, turning and cutting his head. What we have, though, when the visitor was going out of this cave, he had a loss of preta on one side and of hell being on another side. So there is really a lot of karmic retribution. There is the, and in connection with this, monks meditating in the row underneath starts to make sense, especially when we look into next cave that was 1212. Let us look to next cave on actually on both sides, 211 and 213 are with very many inscriptions. Now, the inscription in 2013, there are not only inscriptions, but we also have a skeleton, and not only one. And interestingly, the inscriptions are underneath the skeleton and also above. So the inscriptions were done during really many, many generations. Here is another skeleton. I hope that's the only picture I have from that. Some of inscriptions are written in quite old Brahmi script, so that they are really old. So I wonder actually why should we say that these caves are later than the caves in the middle of Kizil. What are inscriptions about? Many about samsara, about retribution for different sins, and also about visiting of monks, visiting of arhats, were probably staying there in the vicinity, maybe meditating, maybe we also, that's we don't know for sure, but maybe also this real corpse were playing here a special role. Now, this is what our paintings show, already the fact that we have these early paintings really far away in the in the periphery should tell us something that they were already in use, even when definitely cannot say if 212 is earlier or later. Now, cave number 92 is also of importance. This is again not Central Pillar Cave. It belongs again to two first Indo-Iranian style. It is something really very, very peculiar and different, like in later paintings. Above the entrance to the caves, where in second Indo-Iranian style, usually Maitreya is represented, here is Indra with third eye. There is his wife on the side. So that's really something absolutely special and definitely early. Now, in the next vicinity to cave 92, today not existent, but we have description of German Albert von Lecoq, what they had found there. There's something very strange, because usually we have this caves, but this is not a cave. This is a niche of about 20 meter long and the depth only 150. In this niche was a row of rectangular containers out of stone. And in one of the container, this wooden box, which you see on the upper right, was found. It was filled with remains of human bones. The site was probably a burial place for the cremating remains. So all caves stay in one way or another with a ritual of death, maybe with this what we call shraddha ritual. And again, I can only wonder, there are rational reasons why Giuseppe Vignato, whom I really admire, he's an absolutely great scientist, but he says that cave 76 must be the oldest in Kizil. I see rational reason for that, but maybe rational reasons are not all. And there were also this spooky place for Naivasika or who knows whom outside. Coming again to this history and geography on Eastern Turkestan by Heinrich Luders, we had this, that the donations are coming to the monks, but the merit of the donation should benefit the deceased and deities. Now, this is what I said already. First of all, pretas, this hungry ghost, it's absolutely impossible to give them food. But what we definitely can do even till today is to donate to the Sangha, and through the power of the Buddha, pretas will receive the food, they will receive water. This is what we also do have represented in Kizil. There are monks, there are or Buddhas, and pretas, hungry ghosts, were not always depicted in such a way in Kucha. They are shown with bowls. Bowls, they is always for food. So if he is receiving or he is asking, we can be certain that the Buddha will help him. And there is also this wonderful, really much telling representation about pretas, standing monk, kneeling, standing Buddha, kneeling monk, and the monk with the bowl. Thanks to Olga Kinsler, who is with us here today, we even know the literary tradition of that, because only this narrative about preta says something about the river, which is certainly represented here. So it's in Mula Sarvastivada, Vinaya Bhasharya Vastu, Salvation of 500 Pretas by the River Ganges. What is shown here? The Pretas are receiving food, water, thanks to the power of the Buddha, and there is also a monk who stands between them. So when you give, when you donate to the Sangha, can be sure the pretas will receive them. Still, there is a question, who is actually the preta? Of course, hungry goats, ghost, and of course, one of possibilities to be reborn. But preta in the original way, and so we know that in such a way, for example, Ashvaghosha understood the word, there are first of all parents. There are, that's our dear dead, our deceased. So, so maybe we also should take care of them. And to that, we also have some really interesting paintings in Kucha. I published that already. I called them Crossing the Ocean of Samsara. I have no other interpretation of that. Hope it is like that. This is a group of paintings, always on long strips and always representing underneath of something. So there are these jatakas or stories about the Buddhas above in the barrel vault. All they are shown below, underneath the paintings. That's no other places, only in such way. I can show you some examples of them, actually only three, I think. This is how it looks like. This is a lot of water, definitely water, and there are beings in it who are trying to cross it. They are swimming in some examples. Maybe here we will see. Yeah, they are trying to climb the mountains. Some are falling down. Some are. There are some beings coming from above or trying to disturb them, or some are trying to help them. And so that was Kizil. In some later places, like in Kizil Gaha, this being trying to cross the ocean of Samsara, how I understand that, at least in water, they are shown like Tocharians. Not naked like from Indian influenced narratives, but they really look like these donors you have seen on the very first representation, and there is also this one absolutely fascinating representation. So they are sitting here in the boat. There is demon trying to stop the boat. There is a shore that they want to reach. Interestingly, and as far as I'm aware, this is one and only time here. I hope you can see it. That's the hand of this demon, and there is something round on that. I can be wrong, but it looks like a oboe for Charon, that they pay for the demon to reach another shore. Maybe, which is actually in the vicinity, not in Kucha, but in Central Asia, we have archaeology knows that people were having a coin in the hand or in the mouth, so that could have been quite well possible. So whatever it is, if Charon or not, it looks that this Tocharian people in boats trying to reach shore, they really look like local dead people, and who, so in understanding of this preta, like maybe people or beings in Antara Bhava in this time between different rebirths, and that such representations are always shown underneath, that may mean that they can be reborn in just different lives, like the narratives above, which are represented. I would like to close with this quotation from Gregory Chopin, and just maybe to provoke some questions from your side. So Chopin writes, to my mind, absolutely very wise, no one, probably, and unless unduly perverse, would have serious difficulties with the suggestions that the monks who wrote our rules, so Vinaya rules, elite monks, and the monks who annually acted them out, had few, if any, doubts that Naivasika were as real as rocks. All indications are that Buddhist monks in India lived in the world and such things were simply there. Several rules in the Vinayas dealing with legitimate causes for breaking the rain retreat, for example, are entirely based on the assumptions that Bhutas, Amanushyas, etc. are real, hanging around, and capable of considerable mischief. There are no signs of ontological unease. Both the Buddha and the Naivasika were ritually approached and ritually included.